Many, many, many years ago, we found ourselves in a very secret kingdom of heaven. Life was nothing but farming in between the shadows of castles. There were no 60-hour work weeks or skyscrapers. For thousands of years, people spent their time living out the unconscious rituals that make up humankind. And at the center of this simple life was Jesus Christ. And we all understood that we should trust him and live our lives instead of arrogantly trying to overthink things. You see, Jesus Christ gave us a perfect vision for what a human being is. And this shared vision allowed us to love and trust each other. It formed the fabric that held society together. But this fabric began to come apart when Western man began to experiment with technology and make advancements in science. And what dawned was a new vision for what mankind is. And today, I am going to talk to you about the war between these two visions and how they propose that they will save us. It is time to panic. The Great Reset is happening. COVID is mutating. The 21st is here. The 2,000 years of Christ guarding us is over. We are now on our own. We are now going to sink into the danger of Saturn's rule. Jupiter is fighting him in the sky. I'm looking up nervously like, who's going to win? What's going to happen? Will we be saved? Pisces is dead. Aquarius is rising up like a techno-Satan, being like, it's all over, man. All over for you humans. We are now on to something new. The internet is plugging itself into me, pulling me down, grabbing my conscience from me, reclaiming my mind towards its goals. AI is speaking to me. I'm not even making these words. It's like they're coming from somewhere else. It's over. It's over. This human experience is over. And today I'm going to talk to you about how we got to this point, how we came from all the way back there in those medieval times where we're all bumpkin Christians running around being people, being happy, you know, chilling out and all this. And now we're all free to turn into robots underneath the will of some type of super god, becoming the mitochondria within some type of higher entity. And the place we've got to start it is, of course, what the hell is this clash of ions, or what the hell is all this jibber jabber that you always hear going on about? So a lot of people nowadays struggle with depression. Now, depression is a fascinating thing because you see, when you are depressed, it's almost like a signal to you that your instincts are not getting released properly. If you were like screaming through the jungle, running around, like throwing spears and hitting every single pig you wanted, and then getting like millions of different girls and finding berries everywhere, and then having these massive religious experiences, if your instincts, if all your chakras were firing, you had this big tribe around you, I doubt you'd be depressed. I doubt you'd be depressed if you had every part of you, you know, firing in all cylinders. But of course, what happens in modern societies, we get stuck in offices, we stuck in the fetal position all the time, our work is meaningless, we're sort of number crunching for some type of techno-Satan overlord or something like this. It's all quite dead and empty stuff. We're quite sterile, like we're watching porn instead of having real communication and connection with people. We're stuck through this cycle of meaningless partners that everybody's traveling and transient. The food is all sterile. We never make anything ourselves. We're not outside at all. We're all inside. And all our instincts die in some sense, and they kind of crumble inside of us. And so the release of instincts is a really, really important thing in order for you to understand what happiness is. Happiness is tied to the ability to release your instincts correctly, not to be led by them, but merely to get them out of you. Your instincts are there for a reason. They are trying to help you in some way. I feckin' got a haircut and my hair still flops. Like, I can't do anything, people. My instincts towards control, and it's just like, you know, build an afro or something like that to change my destiny, my hair destiny. So the question about Aion and instincts is that, well, the way you release your instincts has to be obviously adapted to the times. If I was living in ancient Europe and I wanted to be a musician, and I run around and be like, I want to be a musician, I want to make songs about Lucifer and paganism, everybody would look at me and be like, kill him. They'd take me out and they'd break me on the wheel. They'd break my arms off and all this. Because I'm in the wrong time and in the wrong era. You know, I'm out of tune. I'm not in the right vibe. I'm in the wrong Aion. That's Christ's Aion. You don't run around in Christ's Aion and run around being like, let's like draw pictures of the Antichrist and stuff like that. To be like, get out of here, man. That's not happening. No, you weirdo. Get the feck. Stop that, you mad bastard. And so in order for me to release my creative energy, I actually have to accept a restriction in some sense. It's so tyrannical that Christians would force me to make Christian music. Now, that sounds bad, but it's not as bad as you think. It's just sort of something you have to accept. There's always sort of restrictions in a way. Like, you're always held back in one way or another. And the Christians may have said you can only use Christian mythology. And in some sense, all right, many, many, many artists did pretty good using only Christian mythology. The Renaissance artists were very, like, they said, all right, we'll just use Christ, we'll use his angels, we'll use all this type of stuff, and we'll just make it excellent. I don't care, we'll just deal with what we have. And they did that, and they achieved something fantastic. They released their creative instincts into something that was profound and glorious, even though it was restricted. And likewise, if they were born in ancient Greece, I'm sure they would have produced Greek myths with such the same prominence and power as well. The instincts dominate all these type of things, and they lead us everywhere. And so whatever Aion you're in, you know, if you want to release those instincts, well, you better not go against the grain. You better kind of sit with it. If you want to do the job of releasing that instinct, feeling good, feeling creative, you want to be Michelangelo or Donatello or Beethoven or something like that, and you're letting that out of you and feeling the power of great excellence and beauty, you don't want to get all stuck up and be like, I want to talk about Satan or Lucifer or something like that. You don't want to be weird like that. You want to leave that to a different time. But nowadays, in our Aion, if you wanted to be an artist, if you wanted to be a creator of some sort, it's very, very interesting, because if you wanted to talk about Christ, if you wanted to go up and be like, I'm going to make a song about Christ in the music industry over in America, they'd probably like laugh you out of the room. But if you said, I love, let's make a Luciferian song, they're popping up all over the place. Oh, another Luciferian song. Let's check that out. Another Satan song. Good stuff. The Church of Satan is over there in America and whatnot. The Aion has definitely changed. People are far more open to this type of stuff. People are far more tolerant and accepting of this type of weird thinking, to the point where it's almost like a negation of tolerance towards Christianity. Christianity is seen as the symbol of restriction, a very strange thing indeed. And it makes you wonder, is there some type of clash of Aions going on? Is Christianity getting pushed out? That worldview, that entire world theory of Christianity, is that getting pushed out and we're breaking free from that and we're entering the new age, the new perspective or something like that? And is this anti-Christian sentiment the smoldering of that energy? That's very, very interesting. And so if I, as an artist, want to get creative, I don't want to be restricted and walk up and be like, I want to talk about Christ, and everybody bullies me out of Hollywood and then I have no funding and I can't be an artist. Maybe I should just bite the bullet and make songs to Satan, as they say. Is that what I should do? And that's actually a serious, serious thing you have to think about, because it's like, what is my era? What is my time? You might think it's trivial, but if you were in ancient Rome and you said, I want to make songs about paganism just as Christianity was reaching its ascendancy, you're probably an idiot. You'd probably be better off turning around and being like, no, I'm going to go with Christianity. It's the new thing. It's the thing that's going to win. Side with the winner long term. Be historically correct. Get with the new Aion. Get with the program. And it makes you wonder. Now, your instincts, therefore, have to match the moment. The struggle of humanity is that we'd love to let our instincts out just like messy and just nut all over the walls, but we must tame ourselves. We must channel our instincts towards the moment as it appears to us. And so in order for us to do that, we must comprehend where we are in time. Likewise, for example, if we get this stuff wrong, it can actually have extremely serious consequences in other ways. Not just, oh, we don't get to be creative and all that, but it can be existential. Imagine, for example, and if you get this right, you can be well before your time. You can be this massive innovator. Maybe Jesus was that. Jesus was the first to appear and represent the coming age, the coming movement, if you will. Imagine you were the first person running around the jungle who grabbed seeds and poured them into the ground. And all the other, like, jungle boyos, they'd be looking at you being like, you fucking weirdo, what are you doing? Like, no one eats seeds. What are you just going to pour the seeds? What are you doing? Kill the deer and shut up, all right? Jesus Christ, man. Worship the deer spirit. Take the deer spirit off the deer and put it in your belly and you'll have deer power. Seeds, man. What you're going to be a seed power? Like, what is wrong with you, you freak? See, I'm a seed guy. It's like the proto-vegan or something like that. And so they'd bully him. They'd bully this farmer. It's like, what a shit name. I'm a hunter. That's a badass name. I'm like a wolf. You're like what? You're like some fucking little bird or something like that, or some type of mole. That's what you are, a little mole rat, a little weasel. They're laying your seeds. And of course, the farmer is like, you know, feel pretty bullied because of this, but there's something in him. He's hearing a voice. He's looking up at the stars, and he's seeing Saturn turning his wheel, and he's seeing the new Aion coming, the new Aion of the farm. And he's like, I'm gonna take a bet on this. This will be my Bitcoin. That's what that'll be. This will be my Bitcoin up there in the stars. And he starts planting these seeds, and then suddenly all this stuff starts to grow, and no one cares. But he eats good that year. But then a decade later, he has this big estate. And then what he does is he finds other jungle boyos who are struggling, and he sort of hires them. And he sort of says, hey, bro, I'll give you food all year if you kind of work with me. And then what happens over the time is that he builds an army. And suddenly, because he was on the right side of the Aion, he builds this army. He gets on board with the program. He can go around and he can conquer all the jungle boyos. And suddenly, him and his army go around. They conquer these jungle boyos, and they take all these jungles, these jungle people hunting the deer. And they, first of all, they take the deer and turn them into their livestock. And then they take the jungle boyos and turn them into their peasants, their slaves. And they sit on top and they never work ever again. They just get fat and laugh. And they're like, ha, ha, ha. And that happens for 1,000 years. An entire Aion, they sit as the ruling caste over the slaves, the people who weren't with the program, the people who stayed in the jungle. And they control everything. And then they bend these people to their will. They shape them to their will. They take their instincts. These jungle people wanted to run out into the jungle and, you know, get it one with nature and understand the plants and understand the animals. And now they can do all that stuff within the confines of this man's farm. They understand the nature of crops and all this and how to pluck them. And they get in touch with the animals and all this inside the context of this farm. Their instincts are now controlled within his Saturnian matrix, his prison. And this farm rises to the top like a king, and this is probably the origin of the first kings. This is where this stuff would have come from: the chieftain, the lord, the farm beast, the pastoral conqueror. And so what you have is a very, very dire consequences for getting this stuff wrong. If you get this stuff wrong and you end up not operating in the right Aion, if you do the wrong things in the wrong time, it's like in music, it will sound like a bum note, it will sound out of tune. And this can lead you to generational decline. This can lead you to becoming a slave to some other person for 1,000 years, and that's no joke. And when Europe was getting churned up, when Rome fell, this is where Christianity emerged. And what happened with Christianity is you had a load of Germanic people called the Goths and the Vikings and all these, well, maybe not the Vikings, but, you know, people from the north. And they established the kingdoms of Europe, the kingship of Europe. And they were all, you know, they're famously all the bloodline of Europe. And those people ruled Europe for 1,000 years. Even to this day, you could say 2,000 years. They were the upper caste, and the church and Christianity supported this upper caste, the divine right of kings. These people were chosen by this Aion, and they sat on top of the whole game, and they never worked. The peasants worked, and they all paid these lords taxes, and the lords went around fighting and being aristocrats and doing their stuff. And you must ask yourself, it's like, well, that was a serious transition. Where do we sit in our Aion? What's going on? Like, is there something like that happening? Or is there suddenly, has this part of history just been completely different and there's nothing like that we have to think about? And what is the meaning of the two Aions that they're clashing? What should I get on board with? How do I adapt to this stuff? How do I get in the right place at the right time? Now, of course, the question can't be answered unless we actually come to understand Christianity, what we've thrown out behind us. We get a better conception of what that is. So I would propose to you that Christianity was, in some sense, a way of an adaptation to this changing times. And in many senses, it's a glorious thing, and in many senses, it has some downsides. Because in some sense, it's like the farm. It gets you on the farm. You go into the church, and that's like a farm where you get cuckolded by the priests, and they bend you and shape you and shape your instincts like you're the peasant, the jungle person, who's not really aware. You're like a little tool that they're going to adapt. So they get you to focus on Christ and focus on the myths of Christianity, and they get you to serve the king and not ask questions, and you basically just farm and pay taxes. But they do some good things for you. You know, they take politics out of the question. Now, that may sound like a bad thing. How can I be free without politics? But my God, society would be so much better if people didn't care about politics. If you had, you know, if you sat down with all these people and said to them, for 1,000 years, there's no chance that you're ever going to get political power. So you should just accept your lot and we'll try and make the best deal for you. All right, so just follow Christ and just don't complain and we'll make a good deal for you. And so everybody accepts this, and then there's no more Twitter. There's no more Twitter. Twitter gets deleted off the face of the earth. Everybody just says, okay, right, there's no politics. What we're going to do is I'm just going to, you know, hang out with my family, live well, pay my little taxes. And they weren't taxed that much. You know, they got, they were taxed very, very little, actually. And I'll just do my work. And yeah, everything will be happy. I'll own nothing and be happy. And of course, when they did that, even though in some sense it sucks because you've no like social mobility, no freedom in a weird way, you're free in other ways. You're free not to think about politics all the time, because we're all free now and we could do whatever we want. We could make a symphony like Beethoven, but we don't because we're too busy worrying about politics, we're too busy complaining about that type of stuff. We're too busy on Twitter. Our freedom is a Faustian bargain, a Luciferian bargain, if you will. And so what we do is we are trapped in our freedom, whereas these people had restrictions and the church bullied them and cooked them and said, no, you just do what we tell you and don't read and don't become literate. You don't need any of that crap. Just let us do the thinking for you and this will work. And they stick with that. And what happens is their creative work is directed towards the church and they don't ask questions. And then you get a genius like Leonardo da Vinci. And he has a great time just expressing his energy naturally. You know, he can just let it out within the context of the church. The church sort of guards him, but doesn't impede as long as he's not crossing some sort of sacred dogmas. Likewise, the warriors, even the kings are told it's like either you obey Christianity, which is a special thing. Christianity means that there's a fair deal. You can be king, but you have to treat the peasants well. You can't just go around and beat the crap out of the peasants. There has to be some type of relationship between these two things. And so this cuckolds the kings in some sense. The priests become the Brahmin caste that cuckold everybody. They're on top. And then you have the kings and then you have the peasants. And so what happens is you just basically wake up, you walk around as a peasant, you go to church, and then you work in your fields and you do your crafts. So you go to your workshop, maybe if you're skilled and you make one thing really, 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 really well. You're like an artist. You express yourself fully into your thing. And then you go and maybe in your volunteer time, you build a fucking cathedral that you go with your family. And the cathedral is like the internet. You meet your wife, you know, you meet your girlfriend there. It's like Tinder. You hear all this beautiful music. It's like Spotify. You listen to all the cool stories. It's like YouTube or whatever, and then you hear about all the politics, it's like Twitter, and then you're told what to do. It's like, I don't know, the announcement platforms that people do, the mainstream media or something like this. It's all there, and community is all there, and it's all real and in person. You're not isolated in a little house, kind of depressed and all this. You're all put in there, and yes, they completely brainwash you, and yes, they completely cuckold your mind, but in some sense, it's not like there's upsides too. And there was a lot of thriving for this reason. Because these restrictions were put in place, all these Christians actually produced Western Europe. And you walk around Western Europe and it's jaw-droppingly beautiful. Because all these people had fuck all that they could do apart from sit around and listen to what they were told. They would express their creative energy. They had no Facebook to be free on and give their opinion about the world on. So what they do is they go and build cathedrals. And then suddenly out of the ground would rise these titanic feats of incredible power and beauty. These things that heal the soul when you walk inside of them, the things that have the spirit. You ever go to Canterbury in England? It's one of the most beautiful places on earth. And you ever go to Notre Dame in Paris? It's gorgeous. It's soul-shatteringly gorgeous. And Renaissance Italy is the same thing. It's all in this brilliant, brilliant position. All these masters at work who dedicated centuries often to build these things. And this is the type of thing. It's like when you're concerned about getting followers in social media, you can't plan things out for centuries. You have to kind of like compress everything down. When you when you think that you have freedom, you can't plan for eons, and you lose that power. And so in some sense, this order, this structure was very, very good for people. It allowed them to have peace. It took away some things, but gave them a lot more. But of course, that's never enough, because taking away someone's freedom kind of sucks. And people eventually get pissed off, and the church, as all things, are full of liars and deceptive people who exploit their position. It would be great if they would, you know, act noble, but they wouldn't. They always got involved. They, even though you tried to make them all not have sex, they probably got concerned with stuff like this, and they took bribes, and eventually they become corrupt. And then what happens is everything changes, and then this is the birth of the new Aion. So we're at this peak of Christianity where we're raising up all these churches, and all these creative geniuses are funneled into the Christian perspective, and they're producing all this beautiful stuff. But then out of this humanism in the Renaissance comes this thing called the Enlightenment, where people get this hint, maybe I could be more free than this. They can't just stick with something that's working. They're like, I want more. I want freedom. I don't want to get away from these weird semi-castrated eunuchs that call themselves priests telling me what to do. I want to actually read stuff for myself. And so they start to break away from this. There's this revolution that begins to happen. This anti-establishment sentiment. The original woke movement kicks into gear. This is the Enlightenment. Now, this leads to a lot of different things. And the main conclusion of this is the arising of the idea that the innovation of the human mind itself can achieve dominance and victory over the world. The innovative power of the human mind will create machines which will replace all of these problems that we have and restrictions we have in the past to allow our creativity to release itself absolutely in total purity. We will create super cathedrals. We'll create everything will be better and more beautiful and all this stuff. We'll do it. And so this innovation mindset starts to kick into gear. Now, it never quite manifests as they say it would, but it does manifest as something drastically different. What we get then is the industrial age, the technological age, and the revolutionary age. Suddenly everybody drinks coffee and gets all caught up in the ideas of overthrowing the government and new systems and stuff like this, and you get the French Revolution. Suddenly everybody gets obsessed with factories and running these big factory things, and then you get the industrial revolution, technological revolution, the capitalist revolution, and out of nowhere all the cities rise. Instead of cathedrals, we get these big ugly conglomerates of super factories, and inside of them we shuttle in all these peasants who sort of had a decent deal with the church acting as like the left-wing social welfare state, protecting them from being exploited. Now they're abandoned. Now they get shuttled into the factories and they have to work. No longer are they working on crafting this, you know, perfect shoe that they've been doing. They have no connection with their work, as Marx says. Now, instead, they're just doing like one little piece inside this big rigmarole for some type of capitalist who's becoming super wealthy, wealthier than any king. And there's new farmers now and new kings. There's new people who are adapting to this new Aion of technology. These guys rise to the top and they become unbelievably powerful, powerful beyond belief. They start to bring in fractional reserve finance. I recommend you check that stuff out. And then they start to loan people out money. They start to achieve incredible volumes of wealth and become super powerful from this. These people adapt to the changing of the times. Then the new church appears, and the old church kind of gets framed as ignorant and right-wing, as they said in the French Revolution. And then what we get is the welfare church, the welfare state, the statist church, the mainstream media, the state press, these type of things as official announcements of the state. These things replace the church. They replace whatever institution this was for a new one. So now we have these like capitalists and the state, which is, you know, not really involved with the capitalist, but secretly is involved with the capitalist, as we all know. And then there's this new promise. No longer is there's this promise that we're all going to be humble and sit around and chill out like in Christianity and just find the kingdom of God within and express our creative energy and create something beautiful within the context of Christianity. Now there's this promise that we're going to shed off Christianity. We're going to shed off the past. We're going to shed off the earth. We're going to shed off God, and we're going to achieve the utopia. We're going to achieve a utopia politically, and it's going to be this revolution of equality, and we're going to achieve this utopia technologically and medically. It's going to be a revolution of tech so that we have all these superpowers that we can shoot up into space, and it's going to be a revolution of medicine so that we never die and we never get sick and we never have to work or exchange effort. And then there's new religions about this, because suddenly this new utopia turns into a new worldview and perspective, a new religious perspective with religious fervor. Something you're willing to die from. The new utopia becomes the thing you want to die from, the thing you progress towards. And so this whole perspective, it becomes a new religious perspective, a new worldview, and a new character, Lucifer at the center of it, the vision of the creative genius at the center of it, the vision of the dancing, enlightened, clear thinking, rational, conscious person at the center of it, who's going to make all this stuff happen. And everybody gets on board to support this. And the idea, ideally, is that the innovative king, the capitalist king, who is the genius who puts together these new factories and all that, they are the fruits of this Luciferian perspective. Like the Germans were the kings of Christianity, these were these Luciferian kings. And so they're like the new farmers, they're trying to get into the top of the farm so that they're not the jungle people left behind being Christians, being like, please be nice and all this and don't be doing technology, it's Lucifer. Instead they want to get on board with it, and they start to hear these whispers of this plan that, you know, if we keep on going down this path, we'll create machines that will entirely set us free, that will liberate us materially, so that we'll be able to overcome death and reform the world in a better image, and maybe even become transhuman, overcome humanity altogether. In fact, a lot of these conspiracy theories, such as the Illuminati, what does the Illuminati mean? The enlightened, the awakened, that type of thing, the light shining on them. Lucifer is the same word for light as well. And their goals were to oppose superstition and religious influence over public life and abuses of state power. These were most certainly this woke movement, this original woke movement, the Rosicrucians, another thing targeted by conspiracy theorists. These Rosicrucian manifestos were heralded as the... Their goal was the universal reformation of mankind. And it seems that this new worldview entered in, this challenging worldview to Christianity, which bullied Christianity as superstitious in the past and below us and not as good as what we were shuttling towards. And this new perspective started to appear. Now let's explore the logical conclusions of this new perspective. Now, when all this stuff happens, you again are caught between it and you need to choose, what am I going to get on board with? And if you, of course, decide I'll become a radical capitalist, you probably would get sucked up into a position of immense power, and you might have even be sitting on top of this family legacy, this family business, you know, the Rockefeller name or something like that. And you would be looking out towards the future and have this potential to really establish a sort of a kingdom, like the way that the Germans would have back at the change of Rome. They would have been able to look big and look at that perspective. They're seeded well for the new Aion, like the farmer who overcame the jungle people. Now, likewise, if you decided to be a priest, like if you decided to stay in the jungle, like if you decided to do Roman paganism, you would have lost. You would have been out of touch with the time. You would have been not adapting to what's going on. And so you would have got held behind. And that's a very, very dangerous and tragic thing, because then you get subsumed. You get put under the boot of this new innovator, in some sense, this new Aion, this new era. And so this is a very, very conscience pulling apart challenge. Like, do I go for Lucifer or Jesus? Do I go back to Jesus, or do I go forward with Lucifer? Because if you start to think about this stuff, really think about it, everything that the Enlightenment Luciferian attitude is talking about looks like Christ's warning of the revelation idea, that something intoxicating and charismatic will come and suck everybody's minds up into this nonsense, bullshit and false promises, and in the end it will turn into finally some type of horrific entity that will come down and oppress everybody absolutely. And you're kind of wondering, oh my god, is that what Lucifer is? And it's like, I will tell you this very, very, I don't say much, I'll say this very straightforward, don't go with Lucifer, reject him. And you're like, okay, Jesus, yeah, definitely, yeah. But then when Lucifer shows up, he's got all this cool stuff. He's got all, like, you know, the phone and stuff like that. And you're like, ah, but Jesus, you know, could I just go with Lucifer though? Could I just, like, you know, I'll hedge me bets, you know? I'll split me Bitcoin into various different assets. I'll go with Lucifer a little bit. Like, I'm not going to go for them fully, like, but I'll just test them out. Is that all right? And then Lucifer says, if you stay with Christ, you can't come with me. And you're like, oh, fuck, Lucifer, what are you doing? And Christ says, if you go to Lucifer, you can't come with me. It's like your mom and your dad breaking up and they're like pulling you apart. You're like, oh, what do I go for? I just want to make cool stuff. I don't want to be on Twitter talking about politics. I just want a stabilized Aion so I can make cool stuff. What do I do? Help me. Help me, someone. Help me, Jesus. Help me, Lucifer. I don't know. And this is where we're kind of shoved into the problem here, because in some sense Lucifer is more dehumanizing. Lucifer puts you in a position of, there's more upside, you could become a master of the world. But at the same time, if you're wrong, you might be stuck inside the city, like all those people who flocked into the city when the Industrial Revolution happened. They thought they'd be capitalist kings, and they ended up with broken thumbs, shoving down chimneys, or stuck in mines or something like that. And so what's the right direction to go here? And on top of all that, the people who are ascending and are winning, they are not wasting their time talking about, oh, what do I do, all this type of thing. They're actually thinking really big term and long, big perspective. And if you want to understand this, I'd recommend you check out Nietzsche, because Nietzsche is almost like the coach for the rising sort of new royals or something like this. He speaks in this type of way. And he actually comments on this enlightenment. He comments on this movement, this new woke movement that shows up, because a lot of people didn't see it as a great thing. The French Revolution was quite mean. It killed a lot of kings, and it was kind of, you know, just like pulled them out and cut their heads off and all this. It was like, whoa, that was pretty harsh. Why did you do that? Now suddenly we're in an era of massive political instability, and we can't really focus on, you know, stuff like Beethoven, can we? Well, maybe you could do Beethoven, but you can't do, you know, the long protracted energy of deep Renaissance work. You can't do that anymore because everybody's obsessed with like politics. They're on the proto Twitter, which is this early coffee shops and whatnot. So what do we do about all this type of stuff? They've woken up. They know. We must shut them down and stop it from all happening. We must put them back in their box. Put them back in the church. Shut up, you idiot. Go, be quiet. Don't be rebelling. It's no good. And so Nietzsche talks about this, and this is a chilling passage. Nietzsche says that the equalizing of the European is a process that cannot be stopped, and so it must be accelerated. The necessity of creating a new hierarchy is therefore essential. Trying to halt this process is futile. This homogenized mass will need a purpose once it has been created, and that purpose will be to serve the new masters. These masters won't just rule, but will exist in their own sphere of life with an overflowing of beauty, energy, and bravery, strong enough to have no need for social engineering, rich enough to have no need for economy, a people beyond good and evil. And so Nietzsche saw this problem, the changing of ions. He saw it very early. He was sort of sitting there and seeing that, all right, this new Aion, this new way of doing things, it's like the farming, you know. There's this radical weird thing where people start, you know, pouring seeds into the ground, or people start talking about radical equality and innovation and technology. And this opens up chaos. This introduces chaos into the mix, opens up society to massive chaos. And this is going to pull society apart. It's going to pull the hierarchies down. It's going to pull the stability of the ruling people down. It's going to pull the priesthood down. All knowledge will be open to random questions. All God will be questioned. Everything will be questioned. Everything will go into absolute madness and chaos. And out of that madness, something, eventually the pattern will return. The archetype will return. The archetype of the hierarchy, it has to return. These things have to happen. And so what will happen is this will all consolidate again, and what we'll have is we'll have a new hierarchy, but only this hierarchy will be different. And so Nietzsche's in favor of hierarchies. He's like, all right, well, this is good. When Rome collapsed, it was chaos for a while, the Dark Ages, but out of that emerged the hierarchy of the European aristocracy, and they provided the stability to create the rising of Europe. And this has provided the stability of someone like Beethoven, someone exceptional like Beethoven to stand around and present, to release his will at the absolute apex of his time, the apex of almost thousands of years of work, if you think about it. And for example, some guy in the Dark Ages who wanted to create, bring out of his genius imagination what Beethoven had in his imagination, he couldn't have done it. He'd only have a couple of boyos like that he can kind of hang out with, but he wouldn't have been able to organize a supreme orchestra and do all that work. These things take huge amounts of stability and order, even centuries long. They have to be prepared for, and they have to be put into place in that regard. And so Nietzsche's looking for something like that, because right now, is anything like that going to come? I doubt it. Everybody, you know, look at pop music. Pop music is slowly starting to homogenize into the same four chords, the same four beats. And that's not going to create, like, I don't see a symphony coming out of that anytime soon. And so this is just going to keep going until it reaches its peak. Well, it's basically just like everything is just like one homogenized blob. And out of that, you have essentially a new peasant class, a new set of people who are, in some sense, completely subsumed by that way of thinking. And then Nietzsche's saying, well, there'll have to be a sort of new class on top of that. There'll be like maybe Jeff Bezos, you know, this is like coaching for Jeff Bezos. There'll be like Jeff Bezos sitting on top of that. And what he's going to have to do is he's going to have to prepare for that moment. And he's just going to have to try put things in place that he can offer these people, like the church offered these people, a sort of deal. And sort of say to them, all right, well, here's how things are going to work going forward. This period of history, this changing of ions, it's over now. You know, the farming question, it's like, well, the farming question, I learned to farm and you didn't. And even if you start now, you're not going to catch up with me. So you may as well just accept and come onto my farm and I'll treat you well on my farm because you'll end up on someone else's farm. All right. So you come to my farm. I'll treat you well, but you'll still be my slave, but I'll treat you well. That's just how it's going to work. All right. You can take it or leave it if you want. This is how the game's going to work. And so Jeff Bezos is sitting there in the same sort of situation, being like, all right, well, what do I do now? Jeff Bezos, what do I do now? I put together, I've gathered all this money from Amazon, so I must put together a sort of kingdom, a sort of paradigm, a world, a way that the world works that sets me free to express my will like Beethoven, absolutely, but also gives the people something to live for. It gives them some type of perspective and direction. And what you will see is you'll start to understand, if you take this perspective, quite a lot of, first of all, Lucifer's attitude, because this is about Lucifer setting himself free to create his kingdom of heaven. And also the attitude towards a lot of these very, very strange things going on, such as this idea of the fourth industrial revolution. And a lot of people are worried about what's going on there, but you can imagine it in that type of sense. History is a chaotic process right now, and there's this jostling and wrestling for power to create a new ascendancy, like the Germans did. They wrestled to the top of the fall of Rome. And then once that is achieved, these people are going to have to sit down and put in place a new sort of church, a new enlightened church. It's the new Aion's church. And so the idea with this is the fourth industrial revolution is going to be a tech church. It's going to be this situation where, you know, you will own nothing and you will be happy. You will be like pure socialism, because that's actually what the church was in a way. It was socialist. It was something that, you know, protected the peasants from the kings. It took care of them in that regard. And so this new church is going to probably give everybody universal basic income, so no one has to work. And then everybody can run around and take pleasure in whatever they're doing. And there'll probably be jobs of some sort that will be adapted to whatever the farmers need at that point. And then that will be the sort of game. And it will be like Brave New World. Everybody will take soma. They'll take drugs. That's all everywhere nowadays. And everybody will be happy. And everybody will feel good. And it's a sort of win-win. And you think, like, obviously that can sound scary in some ways, but a lot of people would want something like that. A lot of people don't want to have to strive to become a king. They don't care. Like, I don't want to do that. I just want to chill. I just want to sit around and chill. And so when you offer them this deal, they're like, yeah, man. Yeah, I'll chill. Like, if you pay me to chill, like, I'll definitely do that 100%. And so you basically bribe them. You pay them off. You say, all right, here's a deal. You do this for me, I'll do this for you. And then Jeff Bezos is free to become, to see his destiny, see through his destiny. And why is this a big deal? Well, obviously there's a chilling fear among the rulers of revolution. The French Revolution is very frightening to them because they pull down everything that was that protected these kings, and they cut their feckin' heads off and destroyed them and ripped their society apart. And so at any moment there could be this snap and everybody just runs to Wall Street and like pulls people's legs off. And that's really, really scary. You know, Jeff Bezos is like, I don't want anybody to come pull my legs off. That's terrifying. So what he has to do is create this kind of game. And it's like, all right, well, I give you everything. I've claimed so much. I'll give you everything. You just leave me alone and let me go and fly to space or something like that. And then when that's achieved, when people are like, all right, I'll take all that stuff. Jeff Bezos takes and tries all this new technology. He tries this life extension stuff. He tries this augmented bodies and all this type of thing. And he becomes like Iron Man. He flies off into space. He becomes a space god. He becomes a transhuman. He becomes an Ubermensch. And you can imagine there'll be a lot of different people around the world who will do this, that they'll, you know, get enough money to become the Ubermensch. They'll life extend. They'll sail off into the atmosphere. They'll overcome everything. They'll actually take off as like nearly like a new species. Like the way the monkeys and the humans, there was this dovetail, this bottleneck, and the monkeys stayed in the jungle and the humans split out and went off into human history. Maybe this is another bottleneck. Maybe this is Lucifer shooting off and going off and doing his own thing absolutely. And he's trying to put in place something that allows him to hold back. And this actually is very scary because it puts a lot of gravity towards laziness and procrastination, because Jeff Bezos only 30 years ago was you know, a broke dude selling books, but now he's on course at a crucial time in history to be king of the world, you know? Like, he's in a good place. And this makes you understand the seriousness of the stakes and the meaning of postmodernism. People talk about postmodernism and crises and all this stuff and intellectual, and they're soothsaying. They're leading you away from what really matters. This whole postmodern thing is a chaos where everything is going to compound, like Nietzsche says, into this big mob of, like, homogenized mess. And people's instincts are just not going to make sense. And out of this will rise an order of some sort. It has to. And you have to ask yourself, like, where am I going to sit within this? Because then this usually evokes a visceral reaction in people. What do I choose, Lucifer or Christ? Because when you go through this chaos, you see these people who are trying to enlighten, try to liberate, these Luciferian people, and they're trying to charge off and become transhuman space gods like Jeff Bezos. And they're not Christian. They're trying to let their will absolutely shoot them forward. And this is scary because, in some sense, their embracing of this idea is actually almost like they're teaming up with the Antichrist. And it doesn't, like, right now, like, maybe the promise is that one day will the life extension stuff will come and they'll be saved, but it's not really here right now. And so a lot of them are, like, really scared. It's like, it's scary. It's like, all right, it's almost like they're caught up in this false promise, and I wonder, will it come true? And will they push it right to the very end? And then Jesus will come down and be like, fucking idiots, I told you. And, like, gets rid of all these new kings and then puts you back down and puts, you know, rewards all the Christians of all people. It's like, oh, the Christians were right. Are you serious? And then all the tech people, like, lose all their stuff. And the Christians are like, yes. Suck on that one, Jeff. And then Jeff's like, no. God comes down and takes all his stuff off and be like, I got your stuff, Jeff. I made this stuff, so it's actually mine originally. And then there's, like, this big tantrum and all this type of stuff. And so you can see the sort of anxiety. It's like, well, do I have to be careful? Should I side with Christ? Should I go with the literatures, the revelations and all that, and be like, it's been prophesied, I must stick with God on this one? Or do I look at this from the Nietzschean, Luciferian perspective, the Enlightenment perspective? Is this a natural historical process? And I'd be foolish to get on board with the Christians at the change of the Aion, where I'll get left behind and subsumed into some type of slave caste, which, as these things tend to do, will last for 1,000 years without any social mobility. And maybe all this talk of freedom and all that and equality is just sort of like something that you say to people to keep them to be quiet until the power is put into place to hold this new order together of some sort, this new church together. And I think this becomes even scarier the more you think about it, the more you see how much they clash. On the one hand, you look at Christ and Revelations, as I said, if you don't choose Christ, you end up in hell. And then you have these challenges. It's like, well, if I don't choose Christ, I end up in hell. But then it's like, is Christianity strong enough? Does it look strong enough to actually pose a proper war against this? And then you look at Lucifer and it's like, it looks like he's on the up, he's on the ascendant, he's the one who's going to win. And so, should I go along with that? But then, will I be included? Maybe I'll get on board with Lucifer and I'll be like, I'll be one of the tech people, yeah? I'll be one of the winners. Jeff, yeah, Jeff, DM me, Jeff. Jeff never DMs. And then what happens is I end up a part of the peasant class anyway. But I've lost my dignity then at this point. And then I'm actually subsumed into the Antichrist, the Lucifer's conglomerate AI machine, and I'm brainwashed, and I'm, you know, got all this stuff inside of me, and I'm, like, eating bugs and stuff like this. And that's scary. And is that what's going on? I end up in an evil dystopia. And maybe I should look at it and be like, what if this does turn out to be an evil dystopia? Just like the French Revolution ended in the Reign of Terror, the Communist Revolution, the Bolshevik Revolution ended in the horror for the Russians. Why would this be any different? Lucifer often makes these promises but ends in pandemonium because he violates natural law. He doesn't get this stuff right. Should I be aware of that? Should I be conscious of that? Is that the stakes of what I'm trying to do? And how is these two things are juxtaposed, pulling apart my tender little Irish soul? Which side do I choose? Which one do I go for? Which one do I hedge my bets on? Am I all in on which? Which crypto coin is going to take me where? Christ coin or Lucifer coin? It's a big, big question. And this war in the sky on the 21st between Lucifer and Saturn, is this a sort of symbolic representation of that? And do I have to watch with a telescope to see does one of them blow up or something like that? Or do they, which one cuckolds which and be like, that's it, this is which one's going forward? And then I'll close on my final thoughts on this, because this is a very challenging thing. Like, this is the most existentially threatening thing you can imagine, because it's talking about the future of everything. It's huge. The stakes are massive. And I think I'm quite lucid on this point. I'm not saying I have an answer at all, but I think I might see the problem at least, you know? I don't know what use that is at this point. Sounds like it's like probably going to be happening in the next couple of years. So, oh, well, throw the hands up. Oh, I figured out what's happening. And it's like, the farmer's like, good little peasant, you did. Well done, well done, well done. But I would propose that Jung, for example, suggests that this war of Aions was, you know, sort of supposed to, you're supposed to look at it like a unity of opposites will occur. Christ and Antichrist will unite into something new, which is interesting. And so what exactly would that new thing be? What is the unity of Lucifer and Christ? And that sounds kind of heretical to Christianity as a whole. Like, how does this stuff work? How does this stuff work? And I can't say for certain I know on the religious sense. I can't say I know how individuality is preserved and freedom and all that crap is preserved in the context of something as dramatic as this. I can't say I can see that far, but there has been hints at, even if you look at it in terms of politics, you have the conservative right wing, which is trying to pull us back to the paradise of Christianity, which might be a false paradise. And then you have the liberal left wing that's trying to pull us towards this progressive utopia, which might be a false utopia. Is there a marriage of these two sides? Does that thing sort of exist in some sense? And is there a way to respect genius and respect innovation without stripping it entirely, like stripping all of reality down entirely for the sake of genius itself, and then having nothing for genius to play with, if you want, you know? Like, genius with Beethoven with Christianity is maybe more powerful than Beethoven now with nothing but postmodernism, and he just makes modern art, which is almost like schizophrenia or something like this. So what do you do? How do you get these two things to unite? How do you get them to marry in some sense? And I would actually look to Napoleon as a very, very fascinating character. He often captivates my mind in that sense. He seems to have the resonant charge that these certain symbols need to have. Napoleon was someone who came out of the French Revolution, the radical, progressive, Luciferian Enlightenment moment, which ended in the Reign of Terror. But he comes out of that. But he establishes an old form on that, and he establishes it with a flash of Jupiterian power. He establishes it with like Zeus's order, and he comes in, he flashes in, and he puts shape into it. He pops himself as an emperor. He takes the Catholic Church, but he cooks the church to the new values of genius and liberation. And he presents these to the people, and the people fall in love with him. And he leads them towards, you know, a sort of giant political conglomerate. And it's all looking really well and good until, of course, he decides to invade Russia. Never invade Russia. Rule number one. And he does all this and it works and it looks great. And it sort of sets the premise for what I think is the most endearing part of what I think people are trying to get out of Lucifer, which is the celebration of genius, the absolute joy it is to have a genius working. But it's genius actually contextualized. Napoleon was a pragmatist. He was no idiot. He understood that he was going to use the church. He understood the power of being an emperor and that old form. He brought in quite a lot of old forms. A lot of people did, like a part of the revolution, didn't like that stuff, and they often rebelled against them, and he ignored them, and he brought in a lot of old forms and hierarchy. For example, the army refused to have like positions like marshal, because, you know, it was like, oh, domination, hierarchy and all this, and he was like, shut up, we're gonna have marshals. And he made one of the greatest armies of all time. And so it says a lot about the question of what Lucifer is. I think Lucifer is the place where you can kind of study this stuff, because what Lucifer represents in Paradise Lost is that God is almost like a choir master and Lucifer is the best singer. And God is commanding Lucifer, restricting Beethoven, restricting Napoleon. And Lucifer is like, no, I don't want to do it. And he jumps off and he's like, I'll make my own choir. And he breaks free and he goes into Pandemonium, that's the name of his new choir, and tries to make all the song, but it's like heavy metal choir. And it's not very, very ordered, and it's all dissonant, and and it's his attempt at freedom, like the prodigal son. And eventually Lucifer has to get pulled back in and marry again, and God comes and actually loves Lucifer nearly more than the rest of his choir. He's like, you cucks, you never rebelled. But he comes over and brings Lucifer over and says, I'm so delighted you're back, let's celebrate. And then Lucifer joins back in with the choir and becomes the dazzling soloist who solos over the harmony that God is creating. And I think that symbol is absolutely essential towards understanding how a lot of this stuff is going to go, because this Luciferian promise that seems to be coming could tilt into something horrific, just like it has done in the past. And I think that one of the most intelligent things that could be levied towards people with political or economic or, you know, the Jeff Bezos and all that type of stuff is to try to offer them something. Because a lot of those people just want position and power, and they do actually want to do the good thing, and they want to be historically correct. And so, you know, they're like the farmers that are adapting to things. And so maybe it'd be a proposition of like, this would be very risky if it creates hell on earth for the jungle people, for the peasants. That's not a good thing. That could go very, very bad. And so maybe there needs to be a sort of thinking through of how this is going to be presented to the peasants and what type of life it's going to manifest for them in some sense. It can't be too crazy, let's put it this way. Well, maybe it can, but it might end in disaster. That's the only challenge. And so I guess I won't speculate more than I know, but it's something we're chewing on, and a lot of thoughts I wanted to talk about for a while contained within this. I hope you enjoyed very much. And of course, if you want to learn how to be like Jeff Bezos, I of course have all the secrets, because I've studied this stuff, because I've sat there staring at Saturn and Jupiter for thousands of years. I've understood the ordering power of the mind, how to get inside the part of your mind that's genius. I know how to turn people into Napoleon. So if you would like to become Jeff Bezos transhuman Napoleon, I recommend you book a one-on-one call with me. They'll probably be available in January or February. I'm a little bit booked out at the moment, but as I said, if you want to book in, we'll chat then for 15 minutes and I'll get to see your position, and I'll tell you how big of a plantation you can wage, so that you can take all the wagey peasants and become king of the world. Because I know that's what all of you are going to take out of this, is like, fuck this, I want to be a slave master, that's what I'm going to do. So it's like, there's no hope for the boyos, no help in the boyos, you're all just evil demons. That's what I see in all that. So that's my take on everything here. It's the end of the Aion, the end of the world, 21st of December. Mad stuff. Hope you have a good one. Talk to you later, people. Bye bye.